Good morning, all. I hope you guys, everybody is doing well. I think you can notice this new microphone, the wireless microphone.
Is it too loud?
Yeah.
Is it too loud? I can adjust it. 1, 2, 1, 2. Testing. We got it? All right, since Kelly's out of town today, so I'm going to make some announcements. First of all, I want to emphasize that BBS is coming up, so Laura, do you have any announcements for that?
Still looking for a 9 and 10 year old leader and 11 and 12 year old leader.
Awesome. Or I'm looking for 9 and 10.
You're going to be the 9 and 10.
Okay. Great.
I do that one.
Okay. If not, there's only one, right? 11 to 12, I can always bump them up.
All right.
But other than that, we're good to go.
And we got an announcement from our town that about the July Jubilee Parade on July 13th. So if you're interested in participating in the parade, then you can reach out to the office. And also, I was going to say about this. It stopped working that the chimes passed 2 or 3 days, and we just called the notification for the chimes, and he came over here, and he and I went into the attic and found the connecting cable was broken. I guess probably mouse. Yeah. He chewed it and he can make it. And we connected it, and it worked fine now. And also, I want to share a joy with you all. At the last annual conference in June, the bishop in the conference, she appointed me to serve our church one more year. In the United Church, all the close groups, they all in the iTrent system. So which means the bishop appoints each pastor, each congregation. So and with that system, under the system, I got the honor to serve another year. So I'm so joyful and delighted. And also today, June 30th, is the day Esther and I we moved in Cambridge 3 years ago, exactly.
So,
yeah.
Yay.
So meaningful.
We're looking for anybody you'd like to do altar flowers for the month of August. Let me know.
All right. And also letting you know, the away and will be on vacation next week. So next Sunday, Jane Oldman, she'll cover the piano part. Thank you, Jane. Away. Every time. Is there an announcement more? All right. Be joined in open prayer. King of all the earth and creator of the universe, from everlasting to everlasting, you are Lord. Your word brings life, O Lord, and we meditate on it day and night. Happy are we, but we walk in your ways, O Lord. You are a rich stream of living waters, and we would immerse ourselves in you through this time of our worship together. Happy are we, but we walk in your ways, O Lord. Who is like our God, the one whose ways are full of life? Happy are we, when we walk in your ways, O Lord. A freedom giving Lord from sin and death, with faith we come closer to you now and offer our praise and thanksgiving for your works in us and through us. We worship you, Lord, this day. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
Celebrate the important holiday this week. Did you know that the annual holiday will celebrate?
celebration.
So you know, holiday will celebrate. 4th of July, Independence Day.
That's right. It is the day of excitement and pride, a day when we celebrate the freedom we enjoy. Do you know what independence means? Freedom. It means freedom. In our country, we enjoy a lot of freedom. We are free to come to church and worship. We're free to choose where we want to live in. We're free to choose what we want to be in the future. It's so obvious, right? What do you mean it's free? Well, I'm telling you, there's some country that they monitor you whether or not you go to church. Because going to church is no doubt. So we are very blessed that we have a lot of freedom, that we can choose most of the things that affect our daily lives. Now, this might surprise some of you, but did you know that freedom isn't free? Someone had to pay the price for us so that we can enjoy the freedom we have. There are men and women who have helped us to pay that price. Some of us here in our church who have served the Army, Navy, Marine, or Air Force. And some of here in our church maybe even served in the fall in the wars and being wounded. There are probably some of here who had a loved one or dear friends who have paid the ultimate price for freedom. They gave their lives fighting for freedom. We have a lot of freedom, and the greatest freedom is the freedom we have in Christ Jesus. The Bible teaches that the penalty for sin is death. Well, you and I are free from that penalty because Jesus paid it. The Bible tells that Jesus died to set us free from the penalty of sin. Instead of that, we are given eternal life. You guys remember John 3:16? Did we memorize the moment? Who said it yet? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Let's do one more time. Let's say it out so that all the parents on the back can hear it, all right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That's right. This week, as you celebrate the Independence Day, let us remember to stop and thank God for those who served the country and helped us to pay the freedom for us. And also let us stop and thank God for Jesus, who set us free from the penalty of sin, because of him, we are free, right? That our freedom wasn't free because Jesus paid the price. So let's pray together. Since we're ready, so let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for the freedom we enjoy in our country. We are thankful for those who paid the price for that freedom, and even more importantly, we thank you for the freedom we have because of Jesus, was willing to pay the penalty for our sins. Thank you for loving us first. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's go upstairs.
Friends, I'd like for us to pray with the prayer for the nation as we hear the word of God. Let us pray together. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit. That as the Spirit is read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear your joy in what you say to us today. Amen. This morning our scripture reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 16 through 21. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake to Capernaum. By now it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I. Don't be afraid." and they were willing to take him into the boat. And immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You pray with me. Holy God, we're so grateful for your love and grace this day. Your love is amazing, never failing. Your grace is always sufficient when we are in need. God, as we listen to your word this moment, you allow us to experience your Holy Spirit so we can open our hearts to you, understand you better, and take courage to follow your calling in our lives when we leave this place. Make the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you and pleasing in your sight. Our believer, our peace, and our joy. Amen. Well, I'm feeling like I've become a telemarketer. I'm moving to become a gospel marketer this morning. The story from today's scripture reading is written in the three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and John. A very famous scripture reading, right? And according to those Gospels, there were two times when a storm in the Galilee put Jesus' disciples in danger. There one was Jesus sleeping in the boat and hearing the cry of the disciples and calming the wind and the water. And the other one was today's scripture. Jesus walks on the water. First of all, I wonder what would be the common message from these two storm-related stories. And I think, even if Jesus is in a boat, or even if Jesus is not in a boat, a storm comes in our lives. And these days there are exceptionally many natural disasters around the world. I cannot help but remind myself of the very last day the Bible warns us. Hurricanes, earthquakes, wildfires, at all times high death and flooding, and even COVID-19. It's still existing. And all of us are living this sort of troubling season. So how are you? How are you? Is your life going well, or are you experiencing any stormy days? Whether or not you trust in Jesus, storms come without fail. And do you know the greater reason this storm was taken as surprise and fear to Jesus' disciples in today's story? Because it was a storm that they met while they are following the word of their God, their Lord. As mentioned, this story is written in the three Gospels, and the Matthew's Gospel offers us the most detailed information. In Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 says, immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat. Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And just before the beginning of today's story, there was a miracle that Jesus fed the last crowd of 20,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And then Jesus himself dismissed the crowd because the crowd began to say, surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world. Then Jesus realized that they intended to come and make him king by force. But Jesus was thinking that his time has not yet come. So he dismissed the crowd and withdrew himself to a mountainside to pray. And at the same time, he purposely sent his disciples on a boat first. Anyways, there will be difficulty in life. Whether or not you keep worship life well, read the Bible on a regular basis, and pray every day, then you think it would be unfair If we face life difficulties or hurdles, even we are working hard in our faith. I know that usually if people are far from God and face difficulties, people are farther away from God. But on the contrary, people who have stood in faith will rather pray more about what God wants to say to them through the troubles. And this morning I want us to be blessed not to be far from God until we finish our journey on earth. And I believe that's the greatest blessing, nearer to God, storm or no storm, nearer to God. And now, let's go back to the story. I want us to remind you again that this storm was a storm that the disciples met while obeying and following the Lord of Jesus. It is true that the storm is no exception to the path of faith and obedience. So what's the lesson from this storm in the Lake of Galilee this morning? Looking at today's passage, after Jesus performed the feeding miracle, he went along to pray, then walked on the sea, and came to the boat where the disciples were. And at the time there was a storm in the sea, and the disciples said they were frightened and afraid again already because of the storm. And when they saw Jesus, they were terrified again. The Matthew's Gospel describes the disciples this way. They were afraid and yelled out, It is a ghost. And the Lord said, take courage, it is I, do not be afraid. And Peter makes a bold faith statement here. He says, Lord, if it is you, command me to come on the water. Lord, if it is you, command me to come on the water. All of the other disciples were feared and couldn't say anything. Peter bravely spoke to Jesus. Obviously, Peter is special, isn't he? However, while Peter was walking on the water to go to Jesus and look at the Lord, he didn't fall into the water. But looking at the storm was scary. So after losing his sight of the Lord, he fell into the water. Quite often we also can be afraid of the situation and reality we are facing. Right? Then we have no choice but to fall in fear. As we read this part, I'm reminded what Christian discipleship looks like. I mean, Christian discipleship often a mixture of faith and doubt. And also individual believers who are believers communities throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, they were often a mixed bag of believing and doubting. We need to note that Peter himself attempted to emulate Jesus by trusting Jesus' power over the storm, but takes a few significant but faltering steps on board. Then see the tempest all about him and begins to sink. In Matthew's Gospel, then finally Peter was drowning and suffering, so he said, Lord, save me. Confessing that his faith was weak. So Jesus rescued him as if raising a fallen child by the hand and said, why did you doubt, you of little faith? Not sure how you received these words of Jesus this morning. Here I think these words are important for us to understand today's story. You of little faith. You may think this is sort of judgment of Jesus for Peter, who doubted about the power of Jesus. But if you remember what Jesus said in Gospel Scripture, you can easily find that little faith contains two implications, judgment and encouragement. The judgment part is easy to understand, right? Here Jesus is scolding Peter for losing his sight from the Lord. However, the encouragement part can be seen in Matthew chapter 17, verse 14, when Jesus promises If you have faith the size of mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. And nothing will be impossible for you. In other words, little faith we have maybe a hindrance at times, but a little faith can also enable us to do amazing things, like move mountains and walk on water. And this is how Christian discipleship works in the Bible and in the history of Christianity. With little faith, we suffer and fear, but with a little faith, we do things amazing and follow Christ. In Mark 6, verse 52, it is written about the reason why the disciples were afraid of the throne, and why Peter was drowning. It says that they didn't understand about the loaves, that their hearts were hardened. Here the loaves indicate the feeding miracle of Jesus with the 5 loaves and 2 fish. Actually, it didn't happen a month ago, nor was it a week ago. Even though it had happened within 24 hours, the disciples had completely forgotten about it because of the storm. You see, when there is a storm, it is so easy to forget the grace that God has entrusted in our life, even if it wasn't a long time ago, and God just accomplished something really gracious and amazing. Nevertheless, our minds easily become cloudy and dull. Jesus' disciples were the same because their hearts had become hardened. Being hardened here means that we have become insensitive to God's word. So if we don't want our hearts to be hardened, in other words, the best way not to become dull spiritually is to remember and look at consciously what God has done every day, every moment. And that is to say, getting closer to the word of the scripture and firmly standing on the promise of the saving grace of Christ our Lord. The Bible consistently speaks to us what we should be afraid of is not the storm, but that we are constantly missing the Lord. And today's message is this: we are anxious and afraid of the situation and reality we're having, which the storm symbolizes. We think that now everything is over, but that's not it. We need to continue to ask ourselves, am I even trying to become conscious of God's presence? Am I living with the word of the Lord constantly? Do I still lift my eyes of faith and look at the Lord? Is it well with my soul? Then there are no worries even in the storm. This is because the Lord who walked in the past will eventually silence this storm. And the disciples experienced in their lives the big storm that could become completely calm in an instant. So they couldn't hide their surprise. Today the Bible testifies that our Lord is the true Son of God, who has the power to rule over nature. And throughout the entire gospel passages, we read Jesus has the power over diseases and over the spirits. But there's something really interesting. Diseases obey the Lord. Demons have to follow what Jesus said, and nature obeys them. Specifically, the wind and the sea obey. But why cannot we, as humans, obey the word of the Lord? Why is it so hard to obey? We need to ponder about it. In many cases, we pray that there will be no storms or only calmness. But do we really pray for God's presence so honestly? We ask the absence of a storm. We ask God the absence of a problem or trouble. We always wish there's only peace. However, the Lord watches us even today to see if we look up with our eyes of faith toward Him. In the conclusion of today's story, verse 21 says that they were willing to take Him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. If you look for this conclusion in the Gospel of Matthew, it ends like this. Matthew chapter 14, verse 33. Then those who were in the boat worshipped Him, saying, "Truly, You are the Son of God." Through this miracle experience, the disciples of Jesus praised that Jesus is truly the Son of God. I pray that the storms of life that we all go through will end with praise and worship, as in today's story. Even if our reality is challenging and the storm frightens us in our life journey, I pray that in the end we will not go to resentment, complaining, or disbelief, but to praise the Lord. Dear beloved sisters and brothers in Christ, the stormy environment never matters because our Lord is with us. So I pray that you can hold on to today's message, that it is not a problem of stones, but that of not being with the Lord, not looking up to the Lord. And may your heart not become hardened because of the storm. And may you remember, whether there is a storm or no storm, will worship and praise God in the end. This morning, our Lord Jesus still says to us, "Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." Then not only will the storm be silent, but we'll also confess our faith, just like disciples who were afraid in the beginning. "Truly, You are the Son of God." Amen. Friends, our centering song is hymn number 397, "I Need Thee Every Hour." We sing in verses 1 through 4. We stand if you're able.
Oh, trust God will finish what he has begun, and we have the privilege of taking part. With grateful hearts, let us bring our tithes and offerings to the God from whom they came. Church God, to be the nation's conscience.
and give to our leaders soundness of judgment and courage of decision, and unite us all in a common deal to honor and praise you and serve others. God of all mercies, we ask for your healing power to our families and friends who are struggling with physical difficulties and spiritual challenges. Merciful God, you give them strength to restore their bodies and spirits, and you keep them safe. You cover them with your grace. We lift them up to God. And that person, Frank Warren, David Hall, Joan Spencer, Nancy Richford, Brett Akeley, Lane Pierce, Tommy Height, Ginger Ferguson, and our community members in many different life goals. Father, help us remember you are God of all creation, and that you give us hope, and you allow us to have faith, to stretch out our arms to you and seek your face. May your Holy Spirit be upon all of us and touch us with your anointing grace. God, we trust in you, and we have one faith in you. Be our refuge, and be our good shepherd. Our friends, let us center ourselves and take steps toward our gracious and faithful God, and seeking for his comforting peace, loving grace, and silence. Holy God, we ask all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Our friends, let us continue to pray as our Lord Jesus taught us what he was here on earth by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is 170, hymn number 170, How I Love Jesus. Please stand if you're able.
power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand, the same power is at work in each one of us who believe. So go from here in confidence and peace, knowing that God's presence and power go with you. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.